Hi everyone, my name is Mandeep and welcome to my YouTube channel. In today's video, we are going to learn about decision trees. In last video, we discussed about how internally decision tree works, how each decision has been taken when we are constructing a decision tree. We discussed about entropy, information gain, and all these concepts in our previous video. So if you have directly jumped onto this video, I would suggest you to have a look on previous video, because that video has great details about these concepts, and it will make more sense if you visit that video first and then come to this video. So in today's video, what we are going to do, we are going to implement using Python code decision tree algorithm. And we are going to create a decision tree model. And so let's get started without wasting any more time. So if very first of all, you guys are on taking a look on this CSV file, this is our data set for our today's model. So in this, I will quickly take you through. This is a CSV file which basically contains data for classifying the cars, whether they are in acceptable or good condition to buy based on certain parameters. So buying, there is a column named buying. Buying represents the buying price. Maintenance, next column represents the maintenance price. Door represents number of doors. Person represents the space or how many person can sit in that particular car. Lug boot is kind of luggage boot space, or you can, in Indian terms, you can think of your dicky. And safety are the safety parameters, so low, medium, high. And this is our class, is our target variable which we are going to predict based on this. So this basically you can read it like a car which has a buying price very high, maintenance is also very high, it has a door, two doors, two person can sit into it, and luggage boot space is very small, safety is low, so it is not so its category is unacceptable, so it's not an acceptable car to buy. Similar way, there are a number of records. So this is our data set, quick overview about the data set. Now let us move on to our Python notebook. And very first, I'm going to step by step. Very first, we are going to import the libraries, required libraries. The NumPy, Pandas, Seaborn, Matplotlib, these are like very basic library and generally required in each of the model. So, and the next, I am reading that CSV file which I just shown to you, using that pd.read.csv method which is in Pandas library. So I just read that into a data frame df, and df.head, as you guys know, that df.head gives the first five rows of your data. So df.head is giving me first five rows of that data. So and these are the details about the columns which I just discussed. These are the like buying, maintenance, door, person, luggage boot, and safety. These are our independent variable, and what each variable or each column represents is kind of mentioned here, and target variable is our class. So very first, we are going to do some quick exploratory data analysis. We want to take a look over on our data. So df.shape will give you the shape of our data frame, like how many rows and columns are there in. So 1728 rows and there are seven columns. Df.info will give you a summary report of your data set, and it will tell you about the column, number of known null values, and count and data type. So This is a quick summary. So there is no null object into this. And again, one more thing which you guys might observe, that all these values are like buying, maintenance, luggage, boot, door, person. All these are categorical variables. And if you take a look at the, now I'm taking a look exploratory, doing a quick exploratory data analysis of my class variable, target variable. I'm just checking like how many types of my class variable, this class variable have values. Like there are 1210 records are available, are there for unacceptable, you can see unacceptable values are there, 1210, and there is for acceptable 384, good, very good. So these are the kind of, this represent the kind of condition of your car. And you can see that this class feature is an ordinal in nature. Ordinal, let me tell you quickly in a very easy way. Ordinal is like when there is a particular sort of order. So categorical variable are of two type. One is nominal and the other one is ordinal. So ordinal are those when there is some sort of order in the values. For example, let's say when we give rating to some product, so like 1 star, 2 star, 3 star, 4 star, 5 star, these values comes in ordinal category. And when there is no particular order among the values of that particular variable, that comes under the nominal type of. So you can see that this class variable is ordinal in nature. That means there is certain sort of order, like unacceptable, acceptable, good, very good, or excellent condition. So this is an ordinal variable. So we will treat this accordingly. Again, in our exploratory data analysis, we can give a quick look. Missing values are again a challenging thing in while creating a machine learning model. So we can see here that in our data frame, there is no missing value for any of the column. So we are very lucky in this case. Otherwise, if there would have been any missing value, we would have to treat it accordingly. And how to treat missing values, you guys can check in my previous videos where I have taken quite deep dive into how to do all this stuff in my previous video. So after that, I am kind of dividing my data set into two variables, kind of feature vector and target variable. Feature vector is the set of independent variables, and the target variable is the that we are going to predict. So what I'm doing here is I'm dropping class variable from axis one means that column wise, I'm dropping it from data frame DF and assigning that. After dropping that, I am assigning that value into X variable, and DF dot class is then assigned to your Y variable. So this is how we kind of split our feature vector and target variable. After that, I'm the regular practice. I'm dividing my data set into train and test split. So what we do in train and test split, we keep certain portion of our data for testing purpose, and rest portion of data is used for training purpose. So here, this is in SK Model Learn library from sklearn.modelselection. I'm importing train test split and passing the value X, Y, and test size represents that how many number of records we want to keep for testing purpose. Here 0.33 means 33% of records I'm taking for testing purpose. Random state means this is just a flag. You can pass any number here. So X train will give you the X train, X test will give you the feature vector with from that we have kept for testing purpose. Y train is the respective target variable for xtrain, and ytest is the respective target variable for xtest. After this, I'm just doing a quick feature engineering. Feature engineering, I'm first checking the data type of each column so that I am sure how I'm going to treat each variable or each feature, how I have to treat it. So as I shared with you that each column or variable in this case is of categorical, and even in categorical type, there are two subtype. One is nominal, other is ordinal. Here we have everything is of ordinal type. So we will create an ordinal encoder. So what we will do, we will encode our ordinal values into numbers using that ordinal encoder, because our machine learning model do not understand the string values or object values. So we need to somehow give their representation of numbers. So we will do this using ordinal encoder, which is in again in sklearn library. So from sklearn.preprocessing, I am importing ordinal encoder, and then I am creating an object of it. And after creating an object of it, I am just kind of doing fit transform over my xtrain subset and xtest subset. So what it will do, it will kind of convert my train and test both of them into ordinal values. So accordingly, it will encode them. So it will convert them into numbers. So for example, if my buying price was representing high, then it will get converted into, let's say, this buying will get converted into here, let's say very high will get converted to some number 1, 2, whatever. So it's a kind of just representation of the same data into numbers. That's the only thing that we are doing here. And after this, now I have encoded my xtrain and xtest. Now it's time to create the model. Since we are doing this example with the help of decision tree, so I have created the object of decision tree. Criterion, inside this criterion, we can pass entropy or Gini index. So on which criteria we want to take a decision of splitting the data set. As I discussed in my previous video as well, in conceptual part, I discussed that we first find the entropy associated with each node, then we find the information gain using that entropy, and then we take the decision that, okay, on which feature we should split our data set. So at each step, this part is iteratively done, and then we are able to construct our decision tree completely. So max depth here defines that maximum number of depth for a node could be 3, because we do not want to take it as a high value. If you will take it as a high value, then depth of the decision tree will increase, and what it will lead to, it will lead to overfitting, and when it will lead to overfitting, then our model will do very good in terms of training, but when we will give the test data, it will perform very poorly. So max depth is kind of to restrict the decision tree to grow immensely. So random state is again, we can pass any value. This is just a flag. And then I'm fit. I'm just training my model over this classifier. And after after training it, then it's time to predict. So to predict, I am passing the xtest subset, and I am just whatever the values have been predicted by model for it, I assigned those into yPred en variable. And now it's time to check how accurately our model is performing. So to check this, we have an accuracy score in our sklearn.matrices in this library, and I just imported that, and I created in the object of this, and I passed ytest and ypred. So that means basically y actual value and our predicted value. Then it compares each value with respect to each actual value and predicted value, then it takes the percentage. Let's say out of 100 values, 76 values are same, then it will give us the accuracy. That means that 76 values are correctly predicted. So this is our model accuracy, which is 76%, which is a good one, not a bad one. So again, and just to check that our model is doing good in terms of this is an extra check. This is not a part of like regular thing, but this is a kind of health check we generally do, that how our model is performing on training and how our the same model is performing on test. So if there is a gap of performance between training and testing, then it's a kind of sign to us to look back on the model, and we fine-tune some of the parameter and then check. What happens generally is that in some of the models, your model performs very good, very high percentage of accuracy in during the training due to overfitting. And when the same model is given the testing data set, it performs very poor. So to check that part, how our model is performing, I just done that part for the same using the same model object. I am predicting for the X train, and I assigned that value into this, and then I'm checking how my model is performing in training. So in training, our model training accuracy on training data set, our model accuracy was 77%, and here it is 76%, which is almost same, and which is a good sign. If there would have been a gap, something like, let's say, during training it was 77 and during testing, let's say it was 50%, then it is a sign that our model is overfitting. So we need to correct that. After that, this is again, which I was just discussing, that I'm kind of checking for underfitting and overfitting. Underfitting means that underfitting is the opposite of overfitting. And in overfitting, what happens is that it performs really good in training, really poor in the testing. And in underfitting, it performs not so good in training, but its accuracy improves in during the testing. So this is how we can check that for overfitting and underfitting. If these values are comparable and almost same, then it is a good sign that our model is not overfitting, also not underfitting. So that's all for today's video. It is a quick video and quick model how we create decision trees, and that's all for now. Thanks for watching. Please guys, do like, subscribe my channel, and stay tuned for more videos. I'm working on machine learning videos, and thanks for watching.